We are going to talk about aviation, regulations, meteorology, flight gear, and more coming up on One Papa Foxtrot, the General Aviation Podcast's inaugural episode.
That's the 2 Mike Hill, your number 2, following Dutchess traffic on a half a mile final, 400 feet, runway 33, clear land.
ATIS Charlie, taxi for takeoff, close traffic.
Runway 24, a Delta clear for takeoff, make right traffic.
Airspeed's alive, looking for 59, up we go, right down with 24.
Runway 24, clear touch and go.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to One Papa Foxtrot, the General Aviation Podcast, with your hosts, Paul Falavolito, a private pilot, and Josh Gelman, meteorologist. Well, welcome everyone to the inaugural episode of One Papa Foxtrot, the General Aviation Podcast. My name is Paul. I'm a private pilot.
And I'm Josh Gelman, the meteorologist.
Yes, you are the meteorologist, Josh. You are the most epic meteorologist that I know.
I don't know about that, but...
Well, it's been about 9 months in the making since we came up with the idea to do this. Many listeners may recognize me from my 7-minute leadership podcast, as well as the emergency management podcast that I used to do. And now more than ever, I'm more excited to be able to do this type of an offering because it is about a subject that I am very, very, very passionate about my whole life. But before we jump into the aviation discussion, since this is episode one, Josh, why don't you tell everyone a little bit about yourself?
What would you like to know?
Who you are and where you're from.
No, let me look it up. So my background, I am a meteorologist by training. I went to Penn State and studied meteorology and math in their meteorology program. It's been over a decade ago now since I've graduated. More recently, I've been working on kind of more broadly using science and technology to reduce risks to critical infrastructure, which of course includes the aviation industry. But I still stay active in meteorology and do a lot of consulting in hazardous weather. So that's sort of a little bit of a background on what I am doing and what I've been up to.
Well, that's pretty good. And you've been a lifelong friend of mine, taught me all about meteorology. I will tell you, when I went through private pilot training because of you, you made the meteorology section bearable.
Right? And that can be hard to do.
Well, it was bearable because I've been am I allowed to say weather geek? Is that
sure,
going to offend
weather
anyone?
Weenie?
Yeah, you know. But yeah, like I've been a weather geek, you know, just as long as I've loved aviation and, you know, what they introduced to you at the private pilot level, you know, there's some pretty heavy stuff in there if you're not ready for it, but you made it quite bearable for me. So that's why this was like a no-brainer to be able to take, you know, both of us, put us together and do this type of a podcast. I think it's going to be very beneficial.
Plus, you know, weather is such an important part to not just general aviation, but all of aviation. I mean, the safety aspect, especially, it's just so important.
Oh, for sure.
To have to know about a lot of different things.
Yeah, no doubt about that. My quick background, I'll keep this very simple. My aviation story, you know, Josh, what's funny is, you know, when I tell this story to people that aren't in aviation, you know, they're like, you know, wow, you've been in been involved in some capacity in aviation your whole life. But everyone that's in aviation, you tell this story to, and they're like, yep, you just told my exact story. It all starts off with my dad had a plane. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Flew on his lap when I was a baby, then tossed into Civil Air Patrol, you know, and just, you know, flying has always been a part of my life. I have a huge aviation family, very happy to be a private pilot now, and currently working on my advanced ground instructor. Did I tell you that?
Yeah, I think you mentioned it briefly.
Yeah, I'm working on advanced ground instructor now, as well as going to be working towards getting my complex endorsement here soon, just because the flight school has a 172 RG that I'm dying to fly. So I'll pick that up. But here we go. So episode one, I got questions for you, and I hope you're ready for this.
We'll find out shortly.
Well, I talked about it in the intro. When we think about the meteorology package that's delivered to a brand new private pilot student, right? Mm-hmm. And they open it up, and here comes the chapter on aviation weather. You know what that entails. I know what that entails. Probably most of the listeners know what that entails. You have a degree in meteorology. Does that wealth of info that a private pilot student gets, does that compare to anything in the professional collegiate meteorology world? Or is it just, do you think it's a hodgepodge of things?
Well, I think that to some degree, the amount of weather information that somebody studying to be a private pilot needs to know is kind of equivalent to maybe an introductory course in meteorology, but there are elements that a private pilot needs to know that you would never learn in an introductory meteorology class either. There's a lot of things that not just related to safety, but also about like the weather services that are offered that would not be covered in an introductory meteorology class. So, you know, for example, in an intro meteorology class, there's probably not going to be a lot of discussion about ASOS versus AWOS or a METAR versus a SPECI and things like that, that a private pilot needs to know that maybe a meteorology student, or at least an intro-level meteorology student, does not need to know. So I do think that there is some overlap between like an intro or a survey meteorology course and what a private pilot needs to know for a private pilot license. But I think that there are also some special things that a private pilot would need to know that a the meteorology student wouldn't.
So if I talk to you about personal minimums, you understand what that means, right?
Yeah.
We've had that discussion. And I think you even played a little bit of a role in me developing my personal minimums. But I want to get your take on this because, you know, with all the tools and the products that are out there to analyze weather, whether it's, you know, you go online and aviationweather.gov,
yeah,
or if you have ForeFlight or Garmin Pilot or something like that, I have a new rule. If it takes me longer than 30 seconds to decide if I'm going to go flying, I probably shouldn't be flying that day. And what do you think of that? Do you think that's...
Yeah, I mean, it's going to certainly depend on your individual comfort level. I mean, you know, if you're... And how much you're into meteorology. I mean, somebody like me, you know, I might want to spend an hour looking at the weather just because I'm interested in it. That doesn't necessarily mean it's an unsafe,
right,
you know, situation. So it really kind of depends on your, you know, your own individual risk tolerance. But I think that for you, that's probably a good metric to go by, you know.
Yeah, I mean, and again, you know, like I'll give you, like this past weekend, for example, here in Western Pennsylvania, temperatures are in the 60s and 70s, you know, here into early November, no clouds, but winds were howling at the airport, mm-hmm, right? So I found myself looking on ForeFlight saying, okay, where's the gap going to be? When are the winds going to, you know, looking at the TAFs, when is the wind going to be less? Or what airport doesn't have winds this bad? And I'm sitting,
yeah,
there analyzing that, and I'm like, okay, I'm going down the wrong rabbit hole. You know, it comes down to, can I fly? Yes. Should I fly? No, probably not.
Or it's like you're almost looking for an excuse or, you know, some sort of excuse to actually want to fly.
Yeah. Like now I'm at the point where, you know, I open it up and I look, and like I said, if it takes me longer than 30 seconds, I'm just not going to go do it. It's just, you know, I'll wait for a better day.
Yeah. You don't get a lot of around here, but...
Yeah, that's true. That's certainly true. But anyways, you're going to bring a lot to this show. Why don't you just surprise everyone now and tell them what you have lined up for us guest-wise?
So we would like to bring in some people from the National Weather Service that are involved, at least from the local National Weather Service office, that are involved with aviation forecasting on a local level. So that would include like the issuance of TAFs. And they will have a lot of useful information that we can talk to them about, and how, you know, a lot about, you know, really what goes into creating a forecast for a terminal, which is really a point forecast. You know, it's just a forecast for within 5 miles of an airport, but and a little bit further if you just start talking about the vicinity, the terminal vicinity. But so they will be really valuable to have on the podcast. And some other people that we might try to get, maybe with the Aviation Weather Center, would be nice. And they could maybe discuss a little bit about SIGMETs and AIRMETs, and also the difference between things like graphical SIGMETs and just a regular text-based SIGMET. And they're out of Kansas, so it would be nice to potentially have them.
Well, you've already reached out to our local NWS Pittsburgh office because you know people, out there. And they've already agreed to talk with us and do the podcast. I'm hoping that we're going to actually be able to just take the show on the road out there and do it. I think that would be wicked cool, just because I've never been to an NWS office. I know that I've said that to you, and I've said that to some of your colleagues before in the past, and you guys both kind of look at each other and you're like, yeah, guy, it's nothing really that spectacular. But nevertheless, I want to be in that atmosphere, so I think that would be great to do. And who knows, maybe they can put us in touch with the Kansas people. I think that would be great. But I do know on my end there's a long list, and I've already reached out to some of the people on YouTube, some of the TikTok aviation community, which is huge. And so I think we're going to be able to line up some fairly decent episodes coming up, as well as we do have a pocket load of CFIs at our disposal, which we can bring in hopefully in one of the next couple episodes and talk to them in depth about some questions I have for the CFIs regarding some students and some things that they are seeing in the ever-trending general aviation community. So how do you think that sounds?
It sounds exciting, and I think that would be great. It'd be nice to even get some of the meteorology folks and the CFI folks together on the same podcast.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, to me, it's all about keeping aviation fresh, if you know what I mean, right? Like, so as a private pilot, I spend more time thinking about flying and wishing I was flying than I can actually physically go up and fly, right? Because we've often talked that the magic number in the general aviation community is, you know, you strive to get 100 hours of flight time a year, mm-hmm. right? But if you do that math times what I spend as an aircraft renter, that's going to be a little north of $18,000 a year, right?
That's a lot.
It's a lot. So even if you cut that number in half and say, okay, is 50 hours financially more reasonable for me to attain? And I'm very close to that for the year. I think I'm at like 43.4 when I last looked at
who's counting?
Yeah. Well, my four-flight logbook counts, Gelman. But yeah, so, you know, that might be a more attainable and, you know, goal for me. But nevertheless, keeping aviation fresh, as you keep talking about safety, I think is an important thing. And that's, you know, watching the YouTube videos, as many as you can from all the different creators out there, you know, going back to even revisiting your old study material.
Yep.
Like I found myself constantly revisiting my old ground school and just saying, hey, where am I at? Let me take a practice test, right?
Yeah.
Type of a thing. The FAA Wings program is another tremendous thing for continuing education and being able to get involved with that. And on all of the sites like AOPA and EAA, they all offer some type of, you know, video series, if you're a member, where you can get on and watch that stuff. And again, it's all very beneficial. Even listening to audiobooks, Gelman, that's like my new thing. I lay in bed at night and I listen to aviation audiobooks all the time.
Yeah, I mean, so, I think it's important to know that it doesn't have to be boring, right? Keeping it fresh.
And
people think safety, oh, that's going to be, you know, suck. That's going to be a boring topic.
Right.
You know, it doesn't have to be.
Right. And so again, even this, you know, even if we spend 25 hours a year recording podcasts, there's still another, you know, hour or so that goes into each episode to research topics and stuff like that. So as long as it's fresh in your mind, and as long as you can fly as much as you can financially accomplish,
afford,
then, you know, I think that plus that equals putting yourself in a higher safety category versus someone that, you know, doesn't fly for 90 days and then doesn't watch anything or doesn't engage their mind in anything aviation related.
Or waits till the end of the year to try and get their 100 hours all at one time.
Yeah, something like that, right? It's just thing. But speaking of hours, right? So, like, let me show you this. And this is what I never let get to zero when we're talking about, you know, we already talk about personal minimums. We talk about safety, right? So, like, here's the logbook in ForeFlight, right? And so everybody that has ForeFlight listening, you guys all have this page. Mm-hmm. So it says last 7 days, last 30 days, last 90 days, last 6 months, last 12 months, and then it lists all your hours. The one that that's allowed to go to zero is the last 7 days. That's allowed to go to zero, right? Because there's no way can I afford to fly every week. I would love to, but the one that I never let get to zero is the one that says last 30 days, mm-hmm. right? Because I know when I was going through training, I have this, it's usually around the 21-day mark, where if I haven't been flying in 21 days, I can start to feel the rust hit. For certain different procedures like landing, or if I go up and I'm practicing, you know, steep turns or stalls or anything like that, 21 days is usually my limit. So, like, I never want my last 30 days to be zero. So that's one of my games that I play with my logbook, is I'll sit here and look and be like, okay, so, like, right now I'm at last 7 days, it says zero, but my last 30 days says 4 hours,
yeah.
right? So I'm good, but now I'm looking at the flight schedule and trying to say, okay, I got to make sure that this does not hit zero, because I don't want to get into that next bracket of then looking at the last 90 days, because I feel like a bad habit is going to develop if I now start to play the numbers game with that last 90.
You're always trying to play catch up. Yeah.
And I don't want to do that when it comes to flying, because I've learned a very valuable lesson this year that when you allow too much time to amass in between your last flight, it becomes very, very expensive to have to redo all that stuff again. And I don't want to do that ever again, because now I've already done that. And so that's why I will let the 7 day hit zero, but I play this game with the logbook where I just don't let the last 30-day numbers ever hit zero.
It's almost like learning a language, and you know, if you're trying to learn a language and, you know, you're studying it every single day and you're using it every single week or every single month, then you're more likely to retain it and be able to actually speak that language. But if you know, just pick up a book or just, you know, open up some sort of app, like you know, a language learning app, and you open Duolingo once every, you know, 6 months, you're probably never really going to perfect that language. So in the language of aviation, you need to be able to, you know, do this on a routine basis in order to commit it to memory and make sure all your skills are still fresh. And
you're 1,000% right. And like I said about the audiobooks, I'm listening to an audiobook right now that's rocking my mind with flying. It's called The Killing Zone. What's it called? How and Why Pilots Die by Paul Craig. Hmm. Right?
That sounds like a...
I wouldn't recommend that any student pilots read it, but after you pass your check ride, it should probably be the first book that you read.
Does it talk a lot about human error and the human
element? Yeah, it does. It talks a lot about different safety elements in regards to aviation. Like, they go through a lot of NTSB case files and break them down and come back and tell you what the probable cause is. But there's been several nuggets of info that are now going to stick with me forever. One of which being, they said that a number of years ago, the FAA did this study where they took a number of private pilots and they reevaluated them at like the 8 month mark and the 12 month mark and the 24 month mark, and just to see where they were mm-hmm. with skills. And they said something like that at the 8 month mark, 51% of them no longer had the ACS standard that they needed for their check ride for maneuvers.
Wow.
51%, right? So, you know, there's some very interesting info in that book. And that's why I said, you know, like even for me, like, I have no problem even as a private pilot, when I hit that 2 week mark or 3 week mark, going out and grabbing a CFI and saying, hey, do you want to go flying with me? Well, I mean, why not? Like, I'm at that age where just me going up alone doesn't like really move my needle anymore.
Yeah.
You know, like when I was 30, I'm like, yeah, okay, you know, I can go do a flight and this is cool and exciting, but you know, now it's just, it doesn't excite me to want to go up alone. I'd rather be with someone else, share it with someone else. If that's another pilot, another CFI or friend or whatever, I would rather have someone else with me. But before I take someone that's friend or family, I want to make sure that I'm on point.
Well, it's kind of an exercise in humility too. I mean, there's always more to learn. You can always learn something, even from a brand new CFI that, you know, you've never flown with. There's probably something that they can teach you, and you can teach them. I mean, it's a never ending process of learning.
Yeah, absolutely, 1,000%. There's always something to learn and something to do, and something that you can get better at. That's why I love being a lifelong student of aviation, and I'm looking incredibly forward to doing more of these episodes and more of these talks here in the future. So as we close out this very first episode, obviously, thank you for making the time and the commitment to want to do this with me. I would love to be able to do this once a week. I would love to be able to get to a schedule where we say, hey, every Monday at 6 o'clock, we're going to release the new episode. Who knows if that can stay that way, but you know, we will certainly try. I look forward to seeing who you can get.
Yeah, I have a few more people. You know, I didn't want to mention it yet, but a few people in mind that, you know, we'll see beyond even the weather service, although they would be the greatest, but you know, just,
yeah, absolutely, they'll be the greatest. I'd love to get some of the tower guys too. I've made some good connections with our local tower guys, so I think I could probably get one or two of them. If not, I got a tower guy on TikTok who said he would do it, which, again, if you're on TikTok, find me on TikTok, Paul Falavolito. But the aviation community on TikTok is awesome. There's some great content that's out there.
Maybe we can interview that bird you hit.
Oh, did you have to bring up the bird strike on episode one? Can we save that for like another episode?
Sure.
Okay. I still might not be over the bird strike just yet. But anyways, that's going to do it for episode one. And please share this, subscribe. A lot of great episodes are coming. Josh, thank you so much for your time.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
Yep. And we will see you guys all for the very next episode of One Papa Foxtrot.